painted faces fill the places I can't reach. You know that I can use somebody. You know that I can use somebody. Someone like you and all you know and how you speak. Countless lovers undercover of the street. You know that I can use somebody. You know that I can use somebody.
G'day, my name's Mick McDonald, this is Cathy Mclean. This is a story about four blokes, motorcycle ride, motorcycle tour company, and Friedreich's Ataxia. Listen and learn.
Friedreich's Ataxia is a progressive neurological disorder. What that basically means is it's a gradual breakdown of the nervous system. It's two sets of nerves that we have. We have placement nerves and we have sensory nerves. My placement nerves, basically what I'm losing. And placement nerves is knowing where your legs and your hands and your fingers are all in space. So if I close my eyes, I fall over because I can't see my feet. It affects pretty much everything but the brain. So it affects speech, it affects coordination, it affects fine motor movements. I have what I quite variably call Cathy moments, where the brain just disconnects from the external limbs. I fall over a lot, had a few broken bones. It comes with the territory. It affects towards the progression of the disease. It will put me in a wheelchair. It will take away my ability to walk, talk, drive a car, feed myself. But in the meantime, we cross our fingers because there's a lot of research going on. So we hope that somewhere in there, through biotechnology, that we'll find some way of manipulating the gene on chromosome 9 that causes the problem. It's kind of a horrible thing to have, but you don't focus on it because it is so slow in its progression. Gives me a bit of time to get used to at least do everything on my life to-do list, I guess. Stem cell research is basically what is going to find a cure for Friedreich's. Unfortunately, stem cell research is still very political. There is a lot of politicians in our government that are very much opposed to it because it is such new technology and there is so many moral levels attached to it. Having said that, there is a lot of politicians and pharmaceutical companies that don't wish to pursue that area. So it gets a little bit frustrating for someone like me knowing that some of the research out there may just extend my life many, many years, but you have politicians that are setting the rules saying, yes, you can research with stem cells or you can't, and they don't realise how many people's lives they affect when they stop that research from taking place. Yes, I've written letters. Yes, I've expressed my concern, but I'm just one person. So it's very frustrating. We've been waiting for trials for as long as I can remember to start in Australia. US have kind of taken over. They're now researching a drug called the debiltating, which I also take, that you can't buy here in Australia, that I have to import. They're researching EPO, although some of that research is taking place in Europe, in Austria. They're researching other drugs that have not received approval to begin research here in Australia. So yeah, they're probably quite a bit ahead of us, whereas we were ahead of them a few years ago. So yes, we sit and we wait. And we get worse and we end up in wheelchairs. I don't think I'm ever gonna make Friedreich's ataxia a household word, like multiple sclerosis or Parkinson's or anything. I think if I was famous like Michael J. Fox, maybe. But I would like a greater awareness so that, number one, people don't presume that when they wobble a bit, they're drunk. they have a greater awareness of appreciation for life. They get out there and do something and not whinge about it all the time.
Just raise awareness.
Yeah.
End of the day, just raise awareness.
I was first diagnosed with cardiomyopathy when I was 18. At the time, cardiologist wasn't too sure how serious it was. Thought I might need a heart transplant. At the age of 18, being told, well, you'll probably go dead by the time you're 38, was enough to kind of make me want to get out and do a lot more, I guess, not waste so much time. Friedreich's was diagnosed at the age of 30, after 2 or 3 years of the balance not being that great. Yeah, that was a bit of a blow. Took a bit to get through that, but that's all right, we're dealing with that. Travelled to close to 60 countries. Started when I first went to Fiji on a holiday when I was 18, so some 20 odd years ago. Met some backpackers and realised how easy it was to travel. So from Fiji, it was a working visit to Canada and then back home, and then a working visit to the UK and Africa, and South America followed after that. And since then, I've been through China and Tibet and Everest Base Camp and seen the gorillas in Africa and Machu Picchu in South America. Seeing the gorillas was a big challenge, mainly because the walk was pretty hard. Shortly after it rained, very muddy. Wasn't wobbly at that stage. I was starting to lose a bit of balance, but I was still walking okay. But it was still a really hard trek. Very worth it, though. Very, very worth it. Don't think many people can say they've been pushed over by a gorilla. So that was definitely worth it. Everest Base Camp, that was hard work. 5,500 metres above sea level. So I think even the fittest would struggle with trying to make it to that point because it is a hard trek. But me and my trusty walking stick, we made it. Machu Picchu, was told by many people couldn't do it. So that just gave me, I guess, more of a reason to prove them wrong. Whitewater rafting down the Zambezi, that was pretty amazing. Came out of the boat 3 times. It took me a year to set up Friedreich's ataxia network, going through all the bureaucratic, I guess, hoops that I had to jump through. But yeah, we got there in the end, but it took me a year to set up after the initial conversation with Mick when we were in South America. Family's more the support. We don't have too much money to be able to support research because research takes millions of dollars. We focus on support to local people that are affected by Friedreich's that need the little stuff like a wheelchair or a hoist or modification to their house if they need to, if they're newly diagnosed. We help in that way. So we also got a lot of information about where people should go, what you should be doing if you've got Friedreich's. A lot of the information that even doctors don't have access to. I had a stroke when I was 37. Stroke was only a minor stroke, if there is such a thing. Put me in hospital for a couple of months. A lot of therapy, a lot of hard work. learning to walk with two-thirds of the sight that I had previous to the stroke. That was a hard work, totally out of the blue, very unexpected. Part of the heart condition, which is part of the Friedreich, so you just gotta roll with the punches. When I broke my ankle and I was in the wheelchair, people were great. Our friend Jackie was brilliant. She pushed me around everywhere and just wanted to help.
I met Cath when I was living in Brisbane. I grew up in Brisbane, and I started to work with Cath about 2.5 years ago.
One of the best things about Jackie is that she does make me laugh a lot, which is great. She's always taking the mickey out of me for the way that I'm walking or how long I'm taking, but no, it's all good. She's really good. Couldn't have done it without the last couple of years.
She was pretty frustrated after the stroke, and I guess I had to sort of try and make her laugh at that point in time because it kind of wasn't funny. You know, on top of having cardiomyopathy and Friedreich's, she then had a stroke. So I've dealt with Cath when she's been in a chair. I've dealt with Cath when she's been on one crutch, and now she's on two. But I say it's funny and I make her laugh. But when you think about it, it's a prick, or a bitch even.
Yeah, you know, it's not easy, but
it sucks.
It does suck.
But then I probably wouldn't like her otherwise. No, true. I probably, if you were able-bodied and all that,
I'd be a different person if I was able-bodied.
You would be.
Yeah.
She probably wouldn't have as much fight in her that she does.
I think everyone's got the fight in them. Just depends on whether you've got to use it or not.
True.
So, don't think it's unique to me. It's just a lot of people don't have to draw on that.
Mm.
So.
No, but there's a lot of people that don't draw on it either.
No, it's a lot of people. Yeah, right. Choose not to draw on it and refuse that they've got the strength.
Mm.
But I think fights in everyone, you just got to find it.
That's it.
So, yeah.
Mm.
Absolutely. So.
There you go. Just another girl getting on with life. And I guess that's what's inspirational about Cath is she is just Cath and she just gets on with it. So, yeah. She takes her knocks, she gets back up, runs at him. Or wobbles.
The first time I met Cathy was in, 2004?
Rio.
I distinctly remember where it was. The Hotel Granada.
Oh, yeah.
7 o'clock in the morning. Cathy was late.
Which I'm never late.
Yeah, right.
The only time I was late.
It was day one. I'll tell you a story walking, someone who cares. It was day one of our 8-week, trans South American journey.
Overland
journey. And there's usually one or two troublesome passengers every trip. And Cathy stumbled out of the Hotel Granada. And I distinctly remember
just
thinking,
woken up.
Distinctly remember saying, Christ, here we go again, another piss head. The idea of a motorcycle ride from London to Vladivostok came a long time before I met Cath. I always wanted to do it, but I wasn't going to do it on my own. But I had managed to con three other friends to join me on a bike ride, 120-day bike ride from London across Siberia to Vladivostok. We toyed with the idea of doing it for charity. It all seemed a bit hard. Our commitment wasn't there. It just, yeah. We just couldn't be bothered, really. Yeah. But we're selfish. It was about us. It was all about us. We wanted to do the ride and, you know, have the fun and all the rest of it. But then we met Cath, and I don't think I said to you at first, I'm going to do this bike ride, we're going to raise money, because I didn't want to raise.
No, I know, but hopes. Sitting just, in the cab at the truck.
Very privileged position.
Yes, you did mention, oh, look, I've been looking at trying to do this ride.
Mm.
You know, maybe. So that's where the idea started from. So
yeah, the idea was in my head. I decided there and then we're going to do it for the charity. You were telling me about the Friedreich's Ataxia Network. I decided that day that we were going to do it for that. But I certainly wasn't going to say to you that it's going to happen because...
didn't want to get the hopes up.
If you get your hopes up, and then, it doesn't happen. All your mates pull out and they didn't do the ride. All that sort of stuff that happens every day of the week.
Yeah.
You're going to be some disappointed people around, so I just kept it fairly under wraps, but yeah. The ride kicked off in 2005, but prior to that, there was a fairly big effort on fundraising, which, to be honest, was, in my view, a complete failure. We really struggled to get any interest whatsoever. I personally emailed over 60 media outlets, newspapers, televisions, magazines, nothing. I had one outlet get back to me with via email saying no, but at least they had the decency to get back to me. It proved to be the most frustrating aspect of the entire project, just that lack of interest. It seemed to me, it seemed like the world just didn't give us stuff.
Welcome to my world.
Not enough people dying. There's just not enough people dying, invisible sorrow for the people to care. I emailed one certain outlet, one media outlet in the town of Wilburundong where I was born, a local newspaper, whose name I won't say, but bought a morning mail. But after four emails, no response, so I went online one day to check them out, what their locals, what was obviously far more important than four guys riding across Siberia, raising some money for a very rare, eventually fatal disease. And apparently it was a family going to extraordinary lengths to find their missing cat. It was far more important. So I remember saying to my mates and to Cathy, maybe we took a cat with us on the trip. Might generate a bit more interest for the new star folk of Wilburundong. I don't know. But anyway, I never heard from them, and that was the theme right throughout the ride. We just couldn't get interest, no matter what we did. It was really bitterly disappointing.
You still managed to raise quite a bit of money for it, though.
Yes, from friends, and we had some events, fundraising events, from people who did care. It's funny, the bloodthirsty horde don't give us stuff, but it was the people who don't have the money, the people in the context of time I hardly knew, and they were my passengers. Yeah, I know for maybe 8 weeks of my life. To be honest, never seen most of them again in my life, but they were just brilliant. They were their hands in their pockets. We had fundraising events in Rio de Janeiro, fundraising event in London, fundraising event in two in Brisbane. So it was a worldwide thing, but no one really gave a damn bar the family, friends and people who I barely knew. So that was restored my faith in humanity a little bit, but it also I realised what a dog-eat-dog world it is, raising money. It really is.
When we were on the London to Vladivostok ride, we got a letter from an email from a guy who's got two daughters who's just been diagnosed as Friedreich's. And it was that brought it home, rammed it home. Like, just how insignificant I thought it was, but how great he thought it was, and just how much that money would help. And little things like, as Cathy said, one lady with that money bought a little lifting device, I guess you'd call it, to help her lift her fully grown daughter out of bed now, who's now completely bedridden. Because of Friedreich, she can't get out of bed anymore and can't do anything. Her body's completely shut down. And so the money went to buying a little sort of crane, I suppose, and helped the mother lift the daughter out of bed each morning to go to the toilet and shower. And
yeah, we raised about 21,000 Australian dollars at the end of the day. For me, very disappointing. I would have thought we raised a hell of a lot more. I just thought it was a good story. We're not rehashed Australian celebrities. We're not out of big names. We're just four ordinary blokes doing what I thought was a reasonably, relatively interesting thing. Not extraordinary by any stretch. So what?
Well, it's extraordinary to the people that you've helped.
Yeah, for me, it's just we rode a motorbike across Siberia. But I just think the whole thing was a good story, and just to have that lack of, if one of them had us got killed, then it would have been fantastic. The bloodthirsty horde would have been there and they're drunk. What if I had got taken by one of Osama bin Laden's mates? Well, it would have even been better. The knife of the throat, wonderful. This is what we want. All of a sudden, people give a damn, but we survived, no one died, all very boring stuff.
We had roughly about $1,500 sitting in the bank before Mick came along. So far, he's made a big difference. So we've been able to utilise that money to provide a lot of support to other people that are affected by Friedreich's. So, big difference. Made a huge difference.
We discussed on the ride, all of us discussed on the ride, we knew the moment we hit the shores of Vladivostok and the ride was over, the fundraising would probably dry up for Friedreich's ataxia.
Which it did.
Most of it did. I'm sure we still get some in.
We still get some, yeah, not a lot.
Yeah. And we knew that. And that sort of, as we predicted, that's exactly what happened. We all went back to our normal jobs. But it ate at me for probably the next 2 years. It just ate at me and ate at me. Not, and I'll be honest, not just the fact that we weren't raising money anymore, but I don't think we were happy in our jobs. I had a new discovered passion for riding motorbikes across around the world and all that sort of stuff. Very boring, apparently. But I knew there would be some people in this world who would be actually interested in riding motorbikes to far-flung places. And it is a life-changing event. Some of the greatest nights and days and nights of my life were on that motorbike with three good mates. So we decided, myself and a couple of mates, we decided we're going to start a company, a motorcycle expeditions company. After many months of battling with each other, we did come up with a name. So that was the first step, Compass Expeditions. And we decided we're going to donate some money out of each booking we get to Friedreich's Ataxia. Not a lot. We're a small company. It's expanding. We're growing. We can hopefully one day be able to really make some form of substantial difference to Friedreich's Ataxia.
Well, at the moment, Brendan and Jerry are in South America working for Compass. They're running the trips, and Mick and I are back here doing our day jobs at the moment. Mick is doing a lot of work for Compass, a lot of the office, backroom stuff, computer stuff, which he really doesn't like. I'm really busy with my legal practice at the moment, but sort of living vicariously through Brendan and Jerry, who are over there and staying in regular contact through email and through the photos they're sending back. So yeah, I'm really jealous that I'm here and they're over there living the dream that all four of us, I suppose, have tried to create. But, you know, that's the way it works. I've got responsibilities here for the time being and things to do. But certainly the plan is that each of us are going to get over there at different times to run trips together. But at the moment, it's Brendan and Jerry's time, and they're doing a fantastic job, and good luck to them.
I haven't met Cathy yet. I'm the only one in the group that hasn't. And I'm really looking forward to it. And hopefully when I get back to Australia, I'm actually going to meet up with Cathy. And I know it's... She's had a really big effect on the company, and she was a catalyst for setting up the company. You know, it's always been a really strong focus, especially, you know, Mick and Jerry and Ryan, who have all met Cath before and had a bit to do with her on their tours. You know, it was always part of the basis for setting up the company and getting this trip up and running. So, yeah, and I suppose, you know, when we get tough days and think about things that are hard for us, and it's nice to bring you back to earth and think about, yeah, you know, everyone has challenges and some are a lot more difficult than others. And yeah, it's certainly a big motivation for all of us to try and do something positive. Yeah, and hopefully it does. And for people to come here and experience another part of life and just realise that we're all human, we all have our basic needs, and you know, it's just nice to be here and to share that with other people and to see other travellers come here and really appreciate it. And to do it on a motorbike, it's just, you know, adds that little extra bit of excitement. But tomorrow we're off to do a bit of a hike of up to around the back of the main Payne Massif around the back there. So we actually have a look on a bit of a lake, and there's a tiny little bit of a glacier, and you look up onto the back, and it's probably about a 4.5 hour walk. Undulating most of the way and damn steep for the last little bit, but it's really impressive. Day after that, we're heading down to Cerro Sombrero. It's probably about a bit over 400 kilometer ride, so we've still got a few k's to go under our belt. We actually have to cross the Straits of Magellan, and then after that we head down to Ushuaia. But I know I've got a bad habit of saying, oh, this is great, but wait till you know, see this. But you know, as you're riding to Ushuaia and you get to a sign that says, you know, welcome to, you know, fin del mundo, end of the world, yeah, you really feel as though you've come a long way. And I sometimes think about people that have flown to Calafate and headed down or taken the bus, but you know, when you take a bike or go in a vehicle, or you really feel as though you've come a long way. You've had a fight with the wind, and you've had a fight with the gravel, and you've had a few swear words and a few laughs along the way, and yeah, your bum's a bit aching and your shoulders are a bit sore, but you know, when you get to that sign and you arrive in Ushuaia and you realise that, you know, Antarctica is just a hop, skip and a jump of the way, it's a good feeling when you get there. Yeah, really great.
Christ, every day you meet a character. there's some cool cats out there for sure. I mean, that guy that we met from Mar del Plata that was riding his Honda 175 with his trailer, he was a dude. He was heading up to see his mum for Christmas, and on the Ripio on the gravel, he averages about 60 kilometres a day, and on the paved roads about 150. And he's just a really passionate guy about life, and he actually reminded me a lot about Cath. You know, he's just out there to enjoy life and to meet people. And it was fantastic to meet him. You know, from the moment we saw him, I gave him the high beams, and he was stopping. We were stopping. We had a chat, and I said, you know, Senor, do you mind if we take a few photos of your ride there that you got? And he was fully into it. And had a good chat to him, got the camera out, had a bit of an interview. Meeting people like that is what life's about for me. You know, you're here, you're taking in the scenery, and if you don't mind what's behind me, it's spectacular. This guy, he had everything that he needed there, you know. Material items for him is what he had to survive. You know, we gave him a bit of our lunch that we had. We had some fruit that we gave him. We gave him a nice Granny Smith apple that probably snapped off his tooth. we gave him a bit of Coca-Cola. And I got his direct address in Mar del Plata. And next time I'm through there in Argentina, I'll definitely be hooking him up. He's a fantastic bloke. And yeah, he's just one of these guys that you meet and you spend 5 minutes of your life with. And, you know, it can change your attitude. You know, you think what life's about for him. And he's just out there enjoying the scenery, totally by himself, self-sufficient, with his bike and his little trailer. And loving it, absolutely loving it. So it's a joy to meet people like that. And that, you know, that reminded me a lot of Cath. His attitude was just like, you got one life, I'm going to live it.
Cathy is an inspiration. If you've met her or if you know her story, it's very inspiring. She has this horrible condition that very little is known about, and yet she has this passion for life that's pretty much unparalleled. She loves travel, and she is going to keep traveling, and it's becoming increasingly difficult for her, but she's not letting it stop her, and she really lives the mantra that we all talk about, which is you're dead a long time and you don't wait until tomorrow, and everyone says it, and some people know it's true and some people don't even think about it, but she knows it's true and she lives it every day. And, you know, full credit to her, she's you know, waging her battle and enjoying her life, and good on her.
My attitude to life, you know, you gotta live. You know, it's a cliche. You got to live every day like it's your last. Cath reinforced that idea to me. I mean, you take your health for granted, and thank God that I'm healthy and living a good life. I was brought up in a Western society where we're fairly well off, but here, being in South America, you see people that are really struggling. You see people that have illnesses. And it makes you think of how lucky you are.
Well, I suppose that the only life lesson that I've got is probably Cathy's life lesson. That is, you know, we're really not here for a long time, and you've really got to enjoy yourself. And, you know, bad stuff will happen to you. But, you know, you get on with it. You enjoy yourself. You enjoy your relationships. You enjoy your family. And, you know, don't sit around waiting on the couch waiting to die. Don't sit and watch Oprah all day. There is a big, wide, interesting world out there, and one of the best ways to experience is to go out there and see what's happening, see how people live, and get amongst it.
Just her guts, her desire to live while the rest of us waltz around whinging and pissing and moaning, my favourite saying, about the most trivial things in life, is just pales into insignificance when you see what she goes through. I can't imagine waking up in the morning, every morning, thinking, well, you know, it's going to be a struggle to get from sunrise to sunset without possibly falling over, breaking my neck. The myriad of other struggles she has to go through. We take things for granted. Walking up a bloody stair, for God's sake, is nothing for us. And running around doing normal things is nothing for us. For her, it's an absolute struggle. and that's the life of a Friedreich's ataxia. Yeah, it was great to have Cath out here when she comes, and but it's a real battle for her. It really drives it home. So it's not about us getting up on stage and handing over big fat checks and having a cloud of politely applauses and slap us on the back to say how good we are, and we all go home feeling fuzzy and warm. We really want to make a friend of ours' life a little bit better, a quality of life a little bit more enjoyable for what life she has, and that's what people do. They help mates. Yeah, big deal. That's what people do, and we aren't looking for accolades or applause or anything. We just want to help a mate. That's it. But we know there's people queuing up to say, oh yeah, people do things, good things, generous things. So they can feel good about themselves and maybe get a little bit of limelight or whatever. That's not what it's about. That's not what Compass is about. It's just about helping a mate. If Ryan was the same, I'd consider it for a minute. Then
I haven't been diagnosed with something that's going to take me 6 months. Well, I mean, it might. But I've had a lot of time to get used to it. I've had a lot of time to sort of go, well, these are things that I want to do, and just get out and do it. I also have gained a lot of knowledge from having what I have that a lot of people do not gain until they're on their deathbed. So, yes, I'm one of the luckiest people. I have great friends, great family. So, yeah. Yeah, I am one of the luckiest people. The money that Compass raises for Van would make such a huge difference. At the moment, the money we've got in the bank, some people would look at and go, that's great. We've got a lot of money, but we don't, as far as charity is concerned. It would mean that we could pay for extra research assistance. We could buy some more horses and equipment for people that need it. We could help modify more houses for people that are newly diagnosed with. The money would just make such a huge difference to so many people's lives. At the moment, making a little bit of a difference to a few people's lives. I'd like to make a big difference to a lot of people's lives. That's what the difference is. So, yeah. I guess just the guys, Jerry and Mick and Brenda and Ryan, they've started a company, it's all fun, it's all new and it's great, but the difference that they're making, I don't think they realise how much of a big difference they've already made, let alone what they're going to do. So they're just a great bunch of guys, really great. They just want to help. Who wants to do that these days? They just want to help. It's great. Unbelievable. So, can't thank him enough. Don't waste your time. If there's something on your life to-do list, or if you don't have a life to-do list, shame on you. But if there is something on your life to-do list that you want to do, then get out and do it, because you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, whether you're going to have time to do it next week, whether you're going to have the ability to do it in 10 years, whether you're going to be alive in 10 years. Don't have any regrets. You know, the amount of people that get to a deathbed and say, oh, I should have done this and I should have done that. Learn from my hindsight. So just do it. Get out there and do it. Just do it. The bank balance is not that important because you can't take it with you. So just get out there and do it. We'll be right back.
But as ourselves, as people running a company, that we actually, we don't lose track of what it's all about. It's about.
Hola. Hola, ¿qué tal?
But just about. cut.
That's right, you know, little Jackie dolls everywhere.
Yeah.
Pushing over Cathy dolls.
Yeah, you like doggy. Look at that.
The documentary's not about the smelly dog.
This is my dog, Coco.
So, do I say one cat and dog or think
it? Think one cat and dog. One Coco and.
Yeah. I think you need to go around.
Yeah. You're just gonna make me laugh. Oh, no, stop it. There's Brent. Love dogs. Can't ask anybody else to go and get Nickers and chocolate, so we're in the hospital. She's been from it. So, yeah, that's just. Yeah. 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 Then the joke went to a bus. Always comes up in conversation. Always. Always.
That remain a secret.
I get the 60 minutes, you get involved.
And no, because that only goes for 60 minutes.
Really?
Oh, 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 really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh,
really?
Oh, really?
Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really? Oh, really?